Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're delighted to have you here today. My name is Becky Norton Dunlop, and I'm a vice president here at the Heritage Foundation. And we have embarked on this partnership with the Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute for over 15 years now. Shortly after I came here to Heritage as a vice president, I said to my team, we need to have a partner in doing these conservative women network events. How about the Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute? And Michelle Easton, who is the president, and my folks sat down. We worked out this great partnership, and it's just been a great success. What we do is we invite 10 of the months of the year an outstanding female leader, someone who's made a difference, is making a difference, and is going to make a difference. And we've had some really outstanding folks, haven't we? Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute has produced a calendar each year with wonderful conservative women in it, and a number of those women have been speakers here. They produced a book with lectures from women. So it's just been a great partnership, and our goal has been to bring together conservative women who work on Capitol Hill and downtown and in think tanks and actually in other places from around the country. We have visitors oftentimes from elsewhere. Not only to hear a great female leader 10 months of the year and a man once a year, and we take August off, but also to get to know each other. And we've had groups that are the size of this group where we have been able to have great conversations, and then occasionally we, you know, kind of blow out the doors and have so many people come that it's hard to get to know everyone who's here. But I just want to welcome you and thank you for coming. My colleague from Claire Booth Luce, as you all know, is not Michelle Easton. Ms. Rodriguez is here representing the leadership of Claire Booth, and she'll be making remarks, and I'll let you handle the questions for Mollie after she makes her remarks. But we have an outstanding speaker today, and her name is Mollie Hemmingway. And I was mentioning to Mollie when I was visiting with her out in the corridor that I first made her acquaintance in 2004. I served on the board of the Phillips Foundation, and we awarded her a fellowship because she was a brilliant young writer. I must say, it wasn't because you were a brilliant young woman writer. It was because you were a brilliant young writer. And that's a great credit to her, but that was a few years ago, and she's just had a tremendous career since that time. But we like to think at the Phillips Foundation we helped launch that. We knew good talent. She now is senior editor of The Federalist, a website about politics and culture. And prior to that, she was morning editor at ricochet.com, which is a conversation site, and managing editor of getreligion.org, which analyzes how the mainstream media covers religion. She is a contributor to the Wall Street Journal's Houses of Worship column and to Christianity Today, where she wrote the column Throwing Inkwells from 2009 to 2011. She has written widely, including contributions to CNN, The Guardian, The Atlantic.com, USA Today, and the Los Angeles Times. In addition, she's appeared on Fox News and on the New York Times bloggingheads.com TV web program. She is a 2014 recipient of the Claremont Institute's Lincoln Fellowship. As I mentioned, in 2004, she was awarded the Phillips Foundation Fellowship to analyze the changing nature of American civil religion. Prior to becoming a religion journalist full-time, she was a reporter for Federal Times, covering issues related to government waste and federal workers. And I must say, I followed her career after we gave her that fellowship, and I mentioned that when she was working for the Federal Times and writing that column, I loved it because I was watching and reading that every day, and it was always nice to know that someone with integrity was actually writing this column relating to government waste and federal workers, and she never had a lack of material, I might say, parenthetically. She is originally from Castle Rock, Colorado, and graduated from the University of Colorado with a BA in economics. She is married to journalist Mark Hemmingway, and they have two children, Evangeline and Lyndon, ages 6 and 4?
Yes.
Okay, very good. And they attend Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Alexandria, Virginia. Let's welcome to our podium Mollie Hemmingway.
I really am an involved mother, so I just have to clarify, they are 5 and 7 now, so they're still around, so they're pretty delightful. And I was happy to be reminded of my work at Federal Times. When I took the job there as a reporter, the beat was waste, fraud, and mismanagement. And during the interview process, the editor said, you know, could you just kind of bounce some ideas off us? Because we've had a lot of trouble with this position. A lot of people have trouble coming up with ideas for stories about waste, fraud, and mismanagement in the federal government. And I was like, well, I mean, how much time you have here? I can just go on. And and it was great training. It was really fun, actually, to be able to study management of federal government and see what goes well and what doesn't go well in that whole process. But we are here to talk about far more important things, Beyonce, namely. And so I wanted to kind of talk just about a couple of different things that I've found interesting with what's going on in feminism right now. And at the end of August, I'm not sure if you remember, but Beyonce gave that like amazing performance at the end of the Video Music Awards. You guys are all probably like too cool to watch the Video Music Awards, but I'm an older lady who is still stuck in the VMA zone or whatnot. So, and I love Beyonce, so I really enjoyed her performance. It was like this 15-minute medley of all of her songs, and it was like totally raunchy. I mean, really well choreographed raunch, but raunch. I mean, you got like intimately familiar with the crotchetal region. But I mean, it really was great, but it was kind of interesting. She's singing songs about, performing oral sex in the back of a limo. There's like a song with some sort of jokey references to domestic violence. There was that scene where all of her backup dancers were completely inverted so that their heads were hidden, and all you saw were like glistening bodies and some of the most amazing derrieres I have ever seen. And there was the part where her backup dancers were dressed in like naked stripper costumes and pretending to be on strip poles. But there's this moment where there's this voiceover about feminism, and then in like really big white letters at the back it says feminist, and she's standing there. And of course, like everybody in the media just couldn't take it. They thought it was so beautiful and amazing that here we have this wonderful feminist, performing for us. And I just thought it was hilarious. I mean, it was just funny to me that that people would take that seriously or whatnot. And the thing that I think is also worth mentioning, and you don't get this in media coverage, is that very few people identify as feminists. So last year, Huffington Post, YouGov did a poll that showed only 1 in 5 Americans identify as feminist. But if you're paying attention to like what the media says, and particularly media directed toward women, you're sort of supposed to assume that it's closer to 100% of people are supposed to be feminist. And definitely in newsrooms, there are people who definitely self-identify as feminist. And what they frequently say is, well, feminism is just the radical notion that women are people too. And if that were true, I think that the numbers would be higher than 20% of Americans identifying as feminist. But I think that normal people have kind of noticed that there's a lot of confusion about what feminism is. It seems to be a lot about a way of advancing a particular kind of politics that might not be agreeable to a large number of women. It sometimes includes a lot of man-hating. And then it also just seems to be kind of inconsistent. So when it's convenient, you say there's no difference between men and women. And then when it's inconvenient for your argument, you say, oh, no, men and women need to be treated totally differently. And it hasn't really been clarified very well why that is the way it is. Oh, I do want to mention my favorite, the night that the feminist, that Beyonce's feminist performance was aired, Cosmopolitan magazine tweeted out a picture of her standing in front of the word with just, the words yes. And I was like, yeah, if you go to Cosmo right now, you're just going to be sent into some kind of like shame spiral of sexual insecurity and get to read about a lot of celebrity gossip. The idea that they'd be like, yeah, that's our feminist hero. Like, I don't want to hear from Cosmo at all about feminism, given what happens if you read. I frankly think like I survived with mental health my adolescence only by not reading Cosmo and other magazines like that. But anyway, so yeah. my nose. Okay, so when that happened with the... Oh, did I mention my other favorite thing about the 15-minute performance? Also included the song, you know, the song where Beyonce gets upset at women who are not sufficiently respectful of her. Bow down. It's a great song, but bow down, biatches. And I also just thought that was, like, not the most normal feminist, you know, message or whatnot. But I always get nervous because... There was a Saturday Night Live skit about the Beyoncé. Did anyone see that? Where it's like, it starts off and there's this like lovely little dinner party going on and everyone's talking about how amazing Beyoncé's new album is. And then one of the guys at the party was like, yeah, but there's that one song that I don't think is so great. And everybody looks at him and they're like, what are you saying? Why would you say that? And he was like, I just don't think it's that great. And they're like, get out, you know, and he gets out. And then it turns out that the whole premise of the skit is that there's a thing called the Beyoncé that tracks down people who are not, like, completely worshipful of Beyoncé. So I'm always a little bit worried when I talk about it. And, in fact, when I did write up that I thought this was funny, that her feminist performance, I did hear from, you know, definite credentialed members of the Beyoncé on Twitter who are really very serious about, you know, you need to, like, bow down. But... 24 hours later, not even 24 hours later, there was another awards performance, and it was the Emmys. And you know that part, like, in every awards ceremony when the dude who's, like, an accountant or maybe the president of the organization who's totally boring talks about, like, the process of the awards or what the award givers are all about, and it's totally boring, and you go to the bathroom or you go get a drink or whatever. During that portion of the Emmys, they did a, you know, kind of, like, silly little thing where they brought out Sofia Vergara, who's of course gorgeous, and they basically had her talk about how she'd always wanted to perform on stage, but she'd never really gotten to do it when she came to America, and it had been a lifelong dream. And so she gets up on this like pedestal that turns around while he talks about the Academy, and at the very end he says, you know, he's talking about, like, the importance of the television industry, and the last thing he says is, what truly matters is that we never forget that our success is based on always giving the viewer something compelling to watch. Ha, ha, ha. So definitely not going to win any comedy writing awards, but it works because Sofia Vergara is amazingly fun, like, compelling to watch. She's gorgeous. She's, you know, I am a woman, and I find her absolutely just, you know, luscious to view. And, you know, it's not, like, really a big deal. It was just that boring part of the Emmys thing. Oh, wow, did the media lose their ever-living minds. So here's some sample headlines. Sofia Vergara was literally put on a pedestal in a completely sexist bit at the Emmys. Sofia Vergara's bizarre objectifying Emmy moment. The Modern Family actress is put on display, literally, for you viewers at home. The Emmys put Sofia Vergara on a rotating pedestal, and it was terrible. The Emmy Awards objectify Sofia Vergara during a speech about diversity on television. I mean, I'm not exaggerating at all. Those are real headlines in real media outlets. And I don't know if, like, the problem was that she had a lot more clothing on than Beyonce did when she did her thing, or if she, like, Sofia Vergara is a little bit more sort of classically sensual as opposed to the, like, spread your legs and let everybody see everything kind of thing of... That's been a finely crafted performance art by Beyonce. And but you guys are way too young to remember Pauline Kael at The New Yorker, but she was sort of famous for pointing out that she literally didn't know anyone who had voted for Dick Nixon. And she was a film critic, and the TV critic at The New Yorker tweets out, on the plus side, the Vergara bit has magically united everyone in my Twitter feed in mutual sorrow and shame. Like, everybody she knew agreed that this was just the worst thing that had ever happened. But I thought it was also interesting to compare, like, the same people, what they said about the two different performances. So you have a guy from, I think it's BuzzFeed, saying, Sofia Vergara was completely objectified in a tone-deaf joke on the Emmys. The previous night, he tweets out a picture of that amazing headless booty display. You know, and I remember, like, in my very secular liberal University of Colorado, when you took those women in media classes, they always told you, like, if you see an ad that doesn't have a woman's face in it. That's the most, like, sexist, misogynistic thing in the world. So I just think it's really funny that these women had no heads. Their heads were hidden. But their glistening derrieres are just amazing to see. So anyway, he tweets out a picture of the booties, and he says, "I cannot with this perfection." So one was horrible, but when you're showing all these things. Oh, and Beyonce is, of course, like spread eagle there. So when there's nothing but these headless bodies featuring, you know, booty, 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 and all this, and, you know, songs joking about Ike Turner beating up on Tina Turner, you cannot deal with the perfection. But when you have a fully clothed woman doing just like a little bit of comedy that's just about how she has a rockin' bod, well, then that's the worst thing in the world. There was this media literacy professor who said, "So last night, Beyonce shows her talent. Tonight, the Emmys show us Sofia Vergara's boobs. Great." So I know this one is very difficult for feminists, but being funny is actually a talent too. You know, comedy is, it's foreign to them perhaps, but comedy is a talent. And Sofia Vergara is one of the highest paid comedians, you know, ever, much less right now. I think she might be the highest paid right now. And also, Beyonce was showing us her boobs and everything else, and that's okay. You know, I mean, she was also showing us her talent. She's a very talented performer. They're both talented performers. They're both, you know, they both have beautiful bodies, and they both know how to work them. But the idea that one is okay and one isn't, and okay, since I'm sure I'm offending half of you already with my language and whatnot, I'll just do one more thing, which is that it's a thing that's bothered me, but in Beyonce's song Partition, which is about oral sex, she has the line, "He Monica Lewinsky'd all over my dress." And that just always gets me, because it really should be, "He Bill Clinton'd all over my dress," because, you know, it's not technically accurate. And I think it's, you know, it's just like also weird that how the blame always gets placed there. But anyway, so Vulture magazine says, "The audience just clapped for Sofia Vergara's butt while she rotated on a disc. That Beyonce feminist moment on the VMAs was pretty cool." And everybody responded to the Vulture, which is, I think, New York magazine's thing. Beyonce humped a couch during her feminist statement. I think that means that both things can be feminist. And another woman said, "You do realize that Bey had a background of glitter butts during her set, right?" And then Think Progress's Jessica Goldstein said, "If the Emmys really want to celebrate women, maybe don't put Sofia Vergara on a turntable." The previous night, she wrote this article where she said, "The image from the night that is still giving me all the goosebumps is Mrs. Carter standing in front of the word feminist, hands clenched in fists at her side." I like that partially because her hands weren't clenched in fists, but she just imagined that that's what it was. But yeah, so just all sorts of disparity between how people in the media viewed one versus the other. But there was also this weird thing, again, and I kind of touched on this already, of this claim that Vergara was not in charge of herself while she was performing this bit. I mean, she's a, again, professional, highly paid comedian. The idea that she wasn't in charge of determining how she would be, you know, how that bit would go is just, it boggles the mind. It's offensive beyond belief. And, you know, a lot of people just refuse to accept that. But one of the people, this guy at Think Progress, Judd Legume, said, "I don't think award shows should feature women on turntables while men talk." And this guy on Twitter, who goes by the handle SM, S period M period, found this thing that was amazing. He shows this video. It's from the Grammy Awards earlier this year. It features a woman on a turntable while a man is talking, and it was Beyonce. So I just think there would be better if we could apply some principled consistency to like what gets approved and what isn't approved. And it's not magically okay to put curvilicious bodies on display when it's someone that, you know, you have an aesthetic preference for over someone else. And it's not just okay if you put feminist on the background. Like if Sofia Vergara had put feminist on the background, which would have been hilarious, actually. I wish she had done that. You know, then it's such a meaningless way to make something okay. And I would hope that feminists would think about that a little bit more. Okay, do I have time to talk about another thing? Okay, yeah. Sorry. So the other thing I wanted to talk about, which I've just been finding very interesting, is how feminism has sort of been struggling to deal with like recreating modern notions of chivalry. And I thought it was really interesting that horrible thing that happened with the hacking of celebrity nude photos, where all these women, you know, had their privacy violated, And people just, you know, it was a major operation to get all these things. But they thought they're putting things in the cloud, which should be safe of, you know, their naked photos. And they were taken and put online, shared by everybody. I mean, very few people were able to resist the urge to check them out. And one of the things that I thought was interesting was the discussion, again, in the media. So when some people said, well, you know, maybe you shouldn't put your naked pictures in the cloud, people got very upset. So this one guy at the New York Times, Farhad Manju, said, I've never heard anyone respond to financial hacking by saying, just don't use online banking. That's what you get for using credit cards. And that's true. You don't hear people say that. And that is actually a really good point. You know, you don't want to make the blame for the situation be the victim, go to the victim of the crime. But, you know, so it's a fine analogy on one hand, but it's actually a really bad analogy that very few people seem to get. You know, the dignity of the human person and how images of women's naked bodies, you know, are out there, that can't be reduced to, like, a commodity. I mean, I know these pictures are valuable, but it's not just about them being financially valuable. And when your credit card is stolen or when you lose money online, you always get made whole again. I mean, I had $300 stolen from an ATM in Mexico. It took me a few months. I got the money back. This one guy on Twitter said, I use credit cards online, but wouldn't if they didn't have loss protection. So the question then is, like, what's the loss protection on naked photos? How do you get that back? You literally can't get it back in this day and age in the way the media work. It's not just celebrities, too. I mean, I sometimes see these very sad stories about girls or young women, but frequently underage girls who, you know, make a stupid decision to share a photo with a boyfriend. They break up. It gets spread around the high school, and the girl ends up committing suicide or something. Now, no one should ever do that. No one should ever be moved to that level of despair over something like this. And it's a, you know, it's complicated how that happens. But this is not just about people like Jennifer Lawrence. This is about, you know, sisters and nieces and, you know, us. It affects a lot of people. And the other thing was that when people said, you know, again, maybe don't take naked pictures or don't put naked pictures online, people said, you know, what next? Tell a woman that she deserves rape for wearing a short skirt, you know. And all these people really reacted negatively to people who did suggest that maybe you not take naked pictures or not put them online. But the thing is, you can simultaneously talk about both of these things. You can talk about how men need to not violate women's privacy or objectify women, and also talk about how you can do things to be safe, too. I mean, there's no need that it has to be a conflict, in my view. If we got robbed at my house a couple years ago, and we do not feel like we deserved to be robbed, but also we thought about how to make it so that it wouldn't happen again. That makes sense. I mean, I think in most crimes, we kind of understand how that works, that we live in a fallen world and that people will be taking advantage of other people, so you want to kind of prepare. There's no reason why you can't do that for situations involving rape or privacy violation. And I don't know if you remember when those University of North Carolina students said that they had found a nail polish varnish that you could put on to determine if you had been roofied. And again, feminists got very angry. They were like, well, that's a great idea. How do we get men to wear this nail polish to prevent rape? You know, meaning like, you know, if it's rape prevention nail polish, it should be applied on the men. Again, there need be no conflict. I think Camille Paglia had said something about don't get fall down drunk at a frat house, and people just came after her like, how dare you? It's like, no, that's actually really good advice. Don't get fall, you know, it's like common sense. But anyway, I do think there's a glimmer of something good here that people should think about, and that, you know, we're so, in this country, we just seem to be like fighting each other, and you pick your side and it's to the death against the other person. But I think, you know, when people are saying these things, they're sort of also acknowledging that there are differences between men and women, and that should be obvious, but it hasn't been in recent decades. And if people are, you know, generally talking about that, that's good. If they're, chivalry is so outdated, so antiquated, so patriarchal. We don't like it for those reasons. And it was a very complex code of behavior. But part of what it was about was taking men and teaching them how to treat people who were more vulnerable than they were. And I think that's what feminists are trying to do. And I think that's not all bad. And I think that there's room for discussion. particularly since when you're not discussing, it goes to very bad places very quickly. So this yes means yes, like dystopian craziness happening in California. You know, that's a horrible idea to take away people's rights as a means of fighting rape. Doesn't, you know, even men should have rights to due process and whatnot. So if you're not having part of that conversation, if you know what that yes means yes legislation, where you have to like verbally agree to all sexual activity, and someone made it funny. I mean, think about what that is, though. That used to be what we called marriage. I mean, now everybody's having sex totally outside of marriage, but it used to mean that was a way of saying yes means yes. I do was a way of saying to everybody in the world, yep, we're going to be having sex, and it's okay, and, you know, you still had the continuing conversations with the spouse, but that's what it was. And so now that we've kind of thrown away all of these systems of dealing with people and managing things, I think feminists are trying to kind of recreate. I think they sense that things have gone kind of poorly. They're trying to recreate, but they need help with that discussion, because otherwise they do stuff like pass draconian measures in California. So I would hope that people on all sides of the aisles kind of try and talk through some of these things, because they are really big issues. Men still are more powerful than women, and they still do treat women poorly in some cases. Some men treat women poorly, and these are problems that are not going to go away so long as humans retain our nature. So we do need to kind of keep the conversation going. Okay, that's all I have.
Okay.
We have time for some questions. I know we have some microphones in the back. If you want to ask a question, just raise your hand, and please wait until the microphone gets to you so we can make sure everybody can hear you. Any questions?
Okay, bye.
I have a question, actually, if I could start it out. We hear a lot these days, especially at Claire Booth Lewis, when we're working with a lot of college students, about this campus rape culture. That seems to be something they talk about a lot lately, and I know that we have a hard time talking with people about it in a lot of occasions, because we can see how the hookup culture may have led to some of this campus rape culture discussion. So I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that, if you have anything that you'd like to say about it.
Well, that's... Yes, that's kind of what I was just getting at. I remember this woman, who is a scholar I admire greatly, saying that, you know, people look at feminism on campus and they're so confused at why it's popular, because it's so full of bad ideas. But if you look at it more as the only means on campus, you know, these slut walks, take back the night, don't tell me not to get falling down drunk at a frat party. You know, if you look at those movements less as about, if you look at them as the only way that young women on campus can actually work to protect themselves, it kind of makes more sense. So I think that, first off, just understanding where that comes from, where that movement comes from, can be helpful, because then you can have a discussion about sexual morality. Yes, obviously things have gone very poorly. The sexual revolution has not worked out terribly well for women. I mean, there are things that you can point to that have worked out very well, but if you look at just, you know, women's own reporting of their satisfaction and happiness, it's gone down in recent decades. There are some women who are able to navigate the sexual free-for-all much more easily than others, but it causes a lot of problems. So I just think being part of that conversation is good, and you can't really, you have to have a coherent sexual ethic yourself. And I am kind of thankful that my parents raised me to just understand from the outset that we were very different than other people in how we treated these things. So I wasn't so shocked when I got to campus and discovered that not everybody was Lutheran, for instance. but just having that idea that you have a different way of thinking about things than what you're going to encounter from other people, I think can be a very good way of engaging on campus, and also teaching people a coherent sexual ethic that makes sense. I mean, I think that I don't know why people don't talk more about it. I mean, it affects so much of our lives, and the consequences are pretty serious for getting it wrong. So I don't know why people don't, you know, talk about it more amongst their friends, but also parents with their children. This is really, I mean, this is the perpetuation of humanity is all built up in this. But also, you know, like even, for instance, and again, I'm sorry, because you're young and I'm being all old and crotchety here, but parents are always like really obsessed that you go to the right school or something like that. It seems like they're really, you know, they spend a lot of time thinking about saving for college and making sure you go to the right college and everything. But like they never talk to you about the thing that actually affects your happiness far more, which is picking a good spouse. And I think parents should spend the same amount of time kind of getting you to the point where you know how to pick a good spouse. Not to say it's always going to happen. You might be, you know, you also need to be prepared for a lifetime where that's not in your, that you don't want to get married or you don't find a spouse or something like that. But when you look at how people rate their happiness, having a good marriage is actually like far more important than where you went to school, which is good because I went to like a third tier public university, but I'm married very well. So, but you know, these are all things that I don't think you can kind of like solve them just by when you get to campus. I think we need to have much larger discussions for everybody at all ages.
Hi, my name is Gabby Morangello and I'm an intern here at the Heritage Foundation. I attend George Washington University, and we just had a student in our campus newspaper write a column about banning the word basic because it is offensive toward women. And I was wondering if you could speak briefly about this, you know, campaign to ban words like basic and bossy from our vernacular and how it's just an attack on free speech and why feminists think that this is something that they should be doing and how it helps women.
Yeah, I think word banning is also really funny. Like, do you remember when the Ban Bossy campaign came out? It was like CEOs of companies, Beyonce again, who all was involved with that? I mean, they were like really high profile, wealthy, beautiful women who were like, hey, we all decided that we're not gonna use this word and you can't either. And it's bossy, which is like the most bossy thing you could ever do is tell people that they can't use a word. But yeah, I mean, the thing is that it's just they're fighting against nature in many ways, which is a losing battle for them. Because if you did ban the word bossy, you'd still have to have a word to describe that behavior. I mean, my children are at that age right now where they actually can be, I mean, love them, but there's that age where you can get a little, your behavior needs to be nurtured in the proper direction. And this is actually true for both boys and girls. And I love this, also the thing that where they go, bossy is not a word used for men. Well, that's because, I mean, first of all, it is a word used for men. But secondly, the words used for men who behave that way are so much worse. I mean, I can't even say them right now because they're so much worse what you call dudes who act that way. And you don't see those words used for women, thankfully. But so yes, it's very un-American, it's very totalitarian, and the left is, you know, disappointingly getting more into word control, thought control, that kind of thing. And that's not freedom-loving, and that's not good. And in America, we don't ban words. I mean, I actually like to bring in words from other languages that mean the same thing. Like, you know, when you study a foreign language and the first thing you do is you learn how to say the bad words because it's funny. I mean, I think we should have bossy. How do you say bossy in French? I'd like to know that, and then I could use that word. No. But, yeah, so it's just, I don't even get the argument, by the way, that basic is, that's, like, I hope it was satire, or I hope that his parents sue for a refund on their tuition dollars, because that doesn't even make any sense. But
it was actually a young woman.
Well, I just realized how sexist it was that I just assumed it was a dude. But, yeah, that just in general, I would say, you know, we do need to speak very well of each other. I mean, that is an important thing. And, you know, in schools, you do actually need to spend a lot of time working on how, like at the school that my children go to, which is a Lutheran school, they're not allowed to behave poorly. They don't obsess over these things like you might see in certain other schools, but we need to speak well of each other. We need to treat each other well from a young age, but banning words is probably not a good way to go about it. Yes. Just kidding. I was going to make a joke about how dudes shouldn't say anything because this is a women's, you know.
I'll keep it very politically correct. No, but okay. I'm actually very glad I attended this talk because obviously feminism has a lot of ramifications for my gender as well. And all right. And so on a more serious note, Jennifer Lawrence did come out, I think, last week or something, and issued somewhat of a justification when she said, in sending, you know, the nude picture to her, I guess, long-distance boyfriend, she's like, well, I had to, because if I didn't send something, he was just going to look for it in other places. And personally, as a man, I find that very insulting that she would think, you know, as a whole, we're that weak, and, you know, that it's just some animalistic desire we have to fulfill. And, I mean, to me, I don't think that's even a position he could hold in the long run, to think that. I think that's really her mentality, unfortunately. I feel bad, you know, I'm not going to criticize her and call her, you know, stupid or names for posting the pictures. I mean, she is a victim, and she deserves sympathy. But I think with a position like that,
No,
I think it's inevitable she'll be hurt again if she just thinks that men need to have that desire filled in such a base way.
Yeah, I thought that was really sad when I read that, and I was very surprised that it didn't get more coverage. I mean, so yeah, she says that she had to take these nude pictures because she had a long distance relationship, and if she didn't, then her boyfriend would just go get other pictures. It's a sad, sad thing to say, and also, this is another thing that I really wish people understood better, that porn is widely used and is extremely damaging to people's sexual health. And I think a lot of people focus on how, like in feminists in particular, might focus on how porn makes women feel bad. You have no idea how bad it makes men feel. I mean, it's a very damaging, it harms their ability to have sex with actual women. It can become extremely controlling. It's very addictive. And it is a very sad thing that we have a culture now where we just sort of talk openly about, oh yeah, well, this is what people do, so no big deal. And it's very hard for men to fight this when it's everywhere. And it, I've never found any argument that it's like not problematic. I've never found those arguments convincing. But the fact that Jennifer Lawrence, who's easily one of the most beautiful women in the whole world, would say that, should suggest something about how a pornified culture is very problematic. And, it's kind of interesting, too, like, we are in such a sexually obsessed culture, and we're so confused about how to handle it. So we do these things like obsess about rape culture on campus. Like, the messages have got to be so confusing for younger people, which is basically like, do whatever you want under any circumstances. But also, we're going to come up with a set of regulations that would make the EPA look like, a children's, cartoon book. And that's very, sex is already complicated enough to navigate, that the incoherency of what makes for moral sexual behavior and immoral sexual behavior in our American culture is just, I think it'd be insane to expect younger people to have any clue how to navigate that. But have fun with it out there, guys.
Hi, my name is Leanna. Thanks for your talk today. I had a question about an article that appeared in the New York Times earlier this week talking about Wellesley, which is an all-female college, and a situation they've had with a couple of students who have now transitioned genders and are identifying as male at an all-female school. And I'm just wondering your thoughts on how is feminism going to respond to this type of development at all-female schools when gender, on the one hand, is seen to be very tied to a woman's physical body, but on the other hand, is defined as something amorphous and changeable. Just wondering coherently, intellectually, how does feminism move forward advocating on behalf of women when what is woman may not be a settled thing anymore?
Well, and I mean, this is actually a very interesting debate that's going on among feminists right now. So there are the people who, I forget what their names are, rad, fem, trans, agenda, whatever. There are the people who say that you have to be trans inclusive to be a real feminist. And there are the people who say this is like a complete violation of what feminism is. And they are fighting with each other. And mostly I just find it interesting to read about, just because the arguments are interesting, because you kind of see different strains of feminism and where they logically progress. I just want to say first and foremost that, again, I think in our very, very, very confused culture right now, this was something you're only going to see a lot more of. And I just feel bad, actually. I think it'd be very difficult to have confusion or about one's sex. I think it would be very difficult if you had issues that made you think that the sex that you are is not the sex you wish to be or feel you are. I think those are very difficult things to navigate, and only more so in our culture, and they're only going to become more so. But to me, when I look at it, I just think, well, this is like a really good indictment of viewing sex as something to be conquered. Your sex, this is what feminism is really about, is about fighting against nature. It's kind of a tangent, but last night I was watching this video where someone had watched Nickelodeon for the afternoon, and she then wrote up about, or spoke about the cartoons that were on for girls' toys versus boys' toys. And I only have daughters, and they're not, one of them is kind of, as you might say, girly, and one of them isn't. And, these are interesting issues, but the whole video that she did was about just being angry that the boys wanted to shoot guns and the girls wanted to take care of babies. I mean, I'm sorry, meet a four-year-old before you do stuff like that. I mean, it's some of these things are so built in, and feminists have a lot of trouble accepting that because it goes against everything that they want in terms of their policies and whatnot. So I think that, again, this is a larger fight against nature. That's a very difficult fight for them to win, although they've been doing, you know, not bad job of it. And so I kind of have confidence over the long run. I mean, it still requires a male and a female to make a baby. This is something that, you know, is still the case despite all of our best efforts to have it be otherwise. And when people say stuff like, and the thing that I found kind of first alarming was when someone asked me what gender I was assigned at birth. And I was like, well, I was made a female by God. Thank you very much. And I view it as a blessing. Like, I view the fact that I'm female as a blessing directly from God. He made me female. And I love that about myself. I'm very happy about it. And it's all, you know, it's a blessing. It's a good thing. I was not assigned something. I was not, you know, victimized with something. And I just read this book, I forget who wrote it, but it's called What Women Want by this Stanford law professor. And she was saying how it's all about how we need to have a, like, better feminist movement that, well, I don't know, it was weird. But she was saying one of the things that was interesting was that nobody wants to be a feminist because it seems like you're just constantly a victim. And that's true. And I think that when you are assigned a gender instead of it being something that's really cool that you get to be, that just is another reason why people don't want to identify as feminists, because it's so, like, it's all about the burden and it's all about the persecution instead of just getting to enjoy this wonderful life. I mean, by all standards, relative to all points in history and throughout the globe, we have a great thing going on here. We are very blessed to be men and women in this country at this time. So the argument that we aren't is, you know, I'm kind of surprised that it's so compelling to even, like, girls on campus and stuff. But
let's get her next. She's been waving her hand for a while.
Hi, my name's Christine. I work for National Review. I actually have written about a lot of the stuff that you talked about. I wrote about Sofia Vergara and I wrote about the cult of Beyonce and Beijing.
Did they come after you?
You did. I spoke at a thing a few weeks ago, and I said, I've never gotten the meanest tweets as when I talk about a celebrity. Like, you think you're insulting someone's mother. I had written an article about the catcalling debate that's going on. The feminist movement thinks it's totally, like, it's a terrible thing, and the conservative movement tends to think, oh, it's a compliment if someone whistles at you on the street. And I actually agreed with the feminists on this one. And I was just curious what your take on it was.
I kind of disagree with both. Meaning, I think that it can obviously be awful to be, I mean, it's, when I lived here on the Hill for many years, and if I were ever walking home alone from the bar late at night, I had to do stuff like, I mean, I had to think about how to make it home safely in ways that just bother me that I have to live in a, you know, in a place where you have to think about that. And certainly catcalling and stuff like that can be just the last thing you want to deal with. So I agree with that. But on the other hand, I love also living in a place where you can just bestow compliments on people. I was thinking about this. I was driving yesterday and I saw this just, like, woman dressed so beautifully, so fashionably. She just looked great and she just had this thing, you know, this way about her. And I almost felt compelled to, like, shout something from the car because it was such a nice thing. You know, I was like, that's so great, you know? And I think in general, it's cool. Like, I think humanity is well served by having those little brief interactions where you can say, oh, I like what you're wearing, or you look really happy today, or something, you know, just, like, no big deal. You can just kind of respond back, yes. And also, I think that, you know, women are very good at navigating social situations, and this is a very important thing for the health of civil society. And so even though it's sometimes unwelcome or unwanted, learning how to navigate that is actually just really good skill for managing, you know, in the office, for, you know, for family life, whatever, you know, raising kids, all that stuff. And so I think that we can kind of just have more balance about the whole thing. But I really do love it when people say something nice to me, and I would hate to live in a world where you can only do that if you've signed an agreement beforehand that it's okay to say something nice to someone. I mean, it really brightens my day when I'm walking down the street and someone says something nice. And men need to learn that skill. of how to give compliments, but women also need to learn the skill of how to receive them. And so, you know, it's just something that we all can do. We're strong people. We'll figure it out. But yes, I'd say just like avoid either extreme.
Hi, my name is Rachel Mikleshevsky, and I'm from the George Washington University. I grew up in a family with a mom and aunts that were all self-identified feminists, but when I got to college, the feminism that I saw at my school was dramatically different than the feminism I was raised on. And I found it really complicated to be in college and identify as a feminist, but have some other feminists tell me that I'm not actually one because I don't agree with different things. Or then on the flip side, talk to people who don't identify as feminists and then look at me differently because I say that I am. Do you think that there's any way that more moderate women can have a larger voice in the movement and like try not to make it a bad or stigmatizing word?
Yeah, I actually just took part in this panel discussion, it's actually a seminar type thing, a couple weeks ago by this group of women who kind of felt like they care a lot about women's issues, and they also care a lot about their faith. So this one Catholic woman and this one Muslim woman put together this group called Alt-Fem, and it's for women of faith who identify as feminists or want to be part of that conversation. And I thought that was just a brilliant idea. They're not like combative. They just want to broaden the conversation so that those of us who are, you know, like just one of the interesting things that was discussed at this panel was from Eve Tushnet, who's this really great writer who has a new book out on being gay and Catholic. And she was saying, you know, she always felt like, basically what she was saying was that the problem with her interacting with feminism is that as a Catholic, she views submission as an ideal. Something that every Christian is called to do. Everybody, even if you're the Pope, is called to submit and learn how to submit to other authorities. And so if feminism is about power and viewing submission as a bad thing, she feels a conflict there where she can't be part of it. And yet she's someone who cares a great deal about women's issues, and she would like to be part of that conversation. And I think there are so many people like that. The vast majority of women, in fact, are like that, as we see that very few women self-identify as feminists, probably because they feel there's this hostility toward those of us who aren't like crazy left-wingers, you know, which is a lot of us. It's, so I you know, again, this book that I read on what women want, it basically said if you aren't like totally sold on this progressive agenda, you don't get to call yourself a feminist. I was like, oh, okay. That's fine. I mean, it's kind of a weird approach for them to take because, for me, I'm not going to be a progressive. I mean, my education and background would, you know, makes that an impossibility. But I do care a lot about women and women's issues, and so I'd like to be part of those conversations. So I think that there's actually, you know, they always take extremes and they pit them against each other, but actually most of us have probably a lot more room for discussion than you get the feeling about by following a lot of major media.
Speaking of discussion, what are your tips for dialoguing civilly, whether in person or in Twitter, with the rabid feminists?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think this is something that people really should think about. Everybody should think about, and I'm kind of appalled. I don't think that there's really one particular group that does better or worse on this. But first and foremost, put the best construction on what the other person is saying. So in our, not trying to be super religious here, but in our Lutheran catechism, we have the commandment against bearing false witness. And it says that we are to put the best construction on what everybody else is saying and doing. That's one of the ways that we keep that commandment. But you don't have to be Christian to follow that. I think it's, or Jewish or whatnot. I mean, that's just a good reminder to not judge other people's motivations. Like, just take what they're saying and go with that. Don't get personally offended by anything. I that's my favorite thing. People go, that offended me. And I'm like, okay. I mean, like, sometimes you're writing something that's, like, completely inoffensive, but, it, you know, it's like, I get the feeling on college campuses, maybe that's a way to tell someone to shut up is to say you offended me. And I'm like, okay. Like, I don't know what to do. You know, I just, you know, put out, I don't know. So I do think, you know, thinking about how to be charitable to other people is good, but other people need to learn how to engage too. I feel like we maybe have had a failure in public rhetoric or communications you know, our schools aren't teaching people how to, like, make an argument. They just talk about feelings. I began what I just said, by the way, by saying, I feel like, which is perfect proof of that. But, you know, just to make an argument and just stick to the facts and don't get personally engaged. I don't know. Don't ever call people names. Don't use all caps. I don't know. I mean, just be nice. And many people won't be. I mean, this is such a silly example, but we're talking about Ebola a lot. And some people are talking about having a travel ban. And some people are saying that that's like the worst idea ever and it's inhumane. So I was just curious if the people, and I don't have a position on this. I have absolutely no position on a travel ban. I'm trying to learn about it. I've heard good arguments for it. I've heard good arguments against it. So I could not be more neutral. But I was just curious if the people who oppose a travel ban in this country also think that the countries that imposed them in Africa, if they were also like racist and inhumane, I was just curious if they had different arguments. And I put the question on Twitter, and then I just was deluged with, like, hateful responses. And I was like, what? I just asked a question. I mean, I was just curious. Like, do they think it was a good idea in other countries but wouldn't be here for some reason or what? Or did they think it was bad, too? I was just curious. And, you know, Twitter does a very good job, and social media do, you know, they make people do things that they wouldn't do in one-on-one conversation. But I just tried to respond calmly, and usually that calms people down. And anyway, sorry. It's my...
Okay, I think we have time for one last one. Did I see a hand in the back there? Okay, going once. Oh, we have a gentleman over here. You mind taking another question from another gentleman?
I feel like I'm in the minority today. I didn't realize it was going to be just women only, so apologize for intruding. But
we have a couple other men.
I was going to ask a question about, I know you had mentioned fighting against nature. I was curious what your opinion is about nature specifically. I know a lot of people appeal to nature as the ultimate authority for human behaviors. And yet in nature, we see so many negative things. You know, I grew up on a farm, so we had a lot of farm animals. You know, and rape is a very natural thing. Doesn't necessarily mean that we want to live up to that. How would you respond to, you know, fighting against nature as potentially being a good thing?
Yeah, no, that's...
Before I let you answer, could you identify yourself for us?
Benjamin Struby. I'm just kind of here representing myself.
Okay.
Yeah. No. I think that is like really interesting. Natural can be a good thing, and natural can be a bad thing. There are things that occur that in nature that you would never want to replicate. You know, violent killing or something. You know. But it's also true that we can learn. Just, you know, humanity has a nature. We do know. I mean, our founding fathers wrote about this quite beautifully. I think that. Humans have a proclivity toward trying to control other people, and so you want to set up systems of government that work so that that's not a problem, or so that that can be mitigated. And so I think that just acknowledging what is happening in nature has nothing to do with whether you're going to, or that, I shouldn't say has nothing, does not therefore dictate what you're going to do. But we do know that no matter what humans you're talking about, whether thousands of years ago or right now, we all have the same nature. We all, we have a, you know, this is why everybody comes up with governments to sort of help work with that. And so I think that those can be informed by many different things. You know, obviously, in where we are, we have been informed by religious, you know, really complicated religious writings and thinking about this over thousands of years. There are certainly other, you know, we've also been quite influenced by secular philosophers, and, you know, we've been doing this for thousands of years. But anyway, what I'm more concerned about, though, is how this fight against nature kind of tends toward violence pretty quickly, and how you know, it's a very totalitarian thing to take what is natural and try and crush it. And so you see that in, you know, the previous century was a century of trying to work against, you know, people's natural organizing. And you see with the attempts to control reproduction that it kind of quickly goes into some more violent areas, or, you know, eugenics. Again, just revisit the last century and you can see some pretty horrible things when people tried to control what happens naturally. So I think we should just be cautious.
Well, thank you very much, Mollie.
Thanks.
And we don't want you to leave quite yet. We have a couple of gifts here
for
you.
Great.
Yes, we do. We have a few things from the Claire Booth Luce Institute. Just to thank you for spending your time with us today. We really enjoyed your remarks. The first thing that I want to give you is our actual limited edition. We're almost out of these.
Nice.
Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute coffee mug with her most famous quote, "No good deed goes unpunished." And don't we know about that?
Thank you.
And where would women be without a fantastic tote bag with which to carry all of their items in? So this is for you as
well.
It's
like you know me well.
I know. It's like we've met in another life. And I will also be giving you a copy of this and let all of you know that our new 2015 Great American Conservative Women Calendar is now available on our website at cblpi.org/calendar, and you'll be getting one of our very first copies.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome.
All right, and let's see here. I think we've got from the Heritage Foundation.
This is the best. This is fantastic. Okay.
We have a new edition of our Heritage Guide to the Constitution.
Wonderful.
Where we take the Constitution clause by clause, and a scholar's written an essay, what did the founders intend when they wrote this?
Nice.
And I believe this one's autographed by Ed Meese, who was the brains behind it and oversaw the production of it. So we'll give you that.
Thank you.
And thank you again. Thank all of you. And I believe we have lunch to serve over in the Van Andel room.